His rock is Jesus. Yes, he the one.
Yes,
that
was that.
His rock is Jesus.
Is there a light at the end of the tunnel?
Say it.
will always be playing catch up.
Well,
Lord, I need answers. I need you to speak to me because I'm between a rock and a hard place. I need some words of encouragement.
Okay.
Lord, I can't seem to stop crying. I need to know if there is a solution somewhere. How can I deal with the dilemmas I'm facing? I really would like my burdens to be lifted. I want to live sometime without criticism and negative talk. Lord, can you help a brother out? The storms of life at one time or another will visit all of us in this lifetime. Jesus said, in this world ye shall have tribulation. Suffering for us is promised in 1 Peter 4:12. He said, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trials which are to try you. In other words, don't get upset when these things happen. Peter is saying, don't think it's something that's just happening to you. It's happening to others as well. Notice in the next verse, he says, but rejoice. Anytime you see the word rejoice or the prefix re, it means to do it again. It means you had all these things happening in your life, but you had joy. And before you had dark days and lonely nights, you had joy. Before the doctor gave you the bad news, you had joy. And since you've gone through trials and you're in them now, you got to redo what you've been doing and go back and rejoice. Now you can't redo what you've never done. How can you rejoice if you've never had joy? But if you're saved, you have experienced joy. And joy does not necessarily mean happiness. Joy is a state of being. Joy is something you are. It's not something you're trying to do. Joy has nothing to do with the kind of instruments being played or the song that's sung or how well you can dance. Joy is who you are and who you are possessed by. And if you have Jesus, you have joy. And one of the many benefits of joy is that it helps us handle spiritual opposition. John the Baptist bothered no one, but he was beheaded for telling the truth. And you don't have to do wrong for people to try to destroy you. People will try to destroy you if you give them a chance. One may wonder, why do we go through all of these things? The response is, if there's a promise of suffering, there's got to be purpose. Suffering chastens us. Hebrews 12:7 says, for what son is he whom the Father chasteth not? When we go through suffering, God is correcting us. The Lord is not trying to make us look like somebody else. He wants us to look like him. And since we're to look like him, he sends storms and trials our way to refine us. Malachi 3:3 says, he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He shall purify the sons of Levi. Suffering serves as a kind of cleanser, a kind of disinfectant, if you will. It takes things out of our lives that shouldn't be there. It purifies us. But storms and suffering also capture our attention. Paul says in Philippians 3:10 that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings be made conformable to his death. We don't know Christ like we think we know him until we've gone through a few things. So when Jesus says to his disciples, let's go over to the other side, the disciples had no idea of the lesson they would learn from this storm. Verse 35 says, and the same day when even was come, he said unto them, let us go to the other side. And what a day it had been. He had faced a fierce demoniac. He had dealt with opposition of family and friends and foes. He had preached and he was tired. The other side lay across 8 miles of water. Several of the disciples were veteran boatsmen and had fished this lake for many years. They had grown up on its banks and its shore had been their playground, so to speak. They knew every curve and current and move. These men knew how to handle their business with oars and nets. Certainly, Jesus was in safe hands. when he boarded their boat, but better yet, they were in safe hands when he boarded.
Yeah.
Still in their mind, they thought this was their realm. So they would, he would leave the sailing to them. Notice the language. He says, let's go over to the other side. He didn't say, let's go under or around, but let's go over to the other side. If he had said, let's go under, you could have rightly expected them to sink. But they were going over. They had a sense of direction because they were following Jesus.
Yes.
We need to know where we're going. If we're traveling, we need to have some sense of where we're headed. And those of us who are believers in Christ know that the reason we're going to heaven is because Christ is on board within our hearts.
Yes.
Verse 36 says, and when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there also were with them other little ships. Mm-hmm. It had been a busy day with crowds of people, and he had loved every minute of it, just as he loved every one of the people. But the day was done, and it was time to get some rest. Even the most popular preacher, with the most enthusiastic and appreciative crowds, come to moments when the crowds have to be sent away.
Yeah.
Every once in a while, get a call, and someone will ask for this, or someone will ask for that. There are certain things you have to delegate to people who handle certain things.
Yeah.
But Jesus understood that and let them go ahead and deal with the rowing and the oars and the waves while he rested. The crowd had finally gone and the ship was ready and it began to pull away from the shore. So he stepped on board as he was. Jesus is the same Jesus is willing to come on the board of the vessels of our lives. But we got to receive him as he is. He's not going to make it up. He's not going to change, but he'll change us. That's just the way he is. He is loving, wise, strong, and holy. We are mean, foolish, and sinful. What he is and what we are not cannot coexist. One of us will have to change, and he won't be changing. Hebrews 13:8 says that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yeah.
We receive him as he is. We should be more careful to tell people that when we share the good news. Zacchaeus received him as he was, and Zacchaeus was changed. Mm-hmm. Peter received him as he was, and Peter was changed. With some people, change is sudden, swift, and sure. With others, it takes more time. We take him on board our lives as he is, because he wants to make us as he is.
Yes.
And you can never meet Jesus and remain the same. Verse 37, there was a great storm of wind, and the waves beat against the ship. And so it was now full. We do understand that the presence of Jesus on board does not guarantee a smooth passage. On the contrary, the enemy will do his best to stir up a storm.
Yes, sir.
We're not exempt from sickness or poverty or natural disasters, bereavement or death, or any of the other ills that this life brings to us. What he promises is not protection from the storm, but his presence in the storm.
Yes, sir.
He does not say as he closed out the Great Commission, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the world. Didn't he say that?
Yes.
Did he not promise, I will never leave you nor forsake you?
Yes, sir.
Did he not promise the children of Israel, my presence will go with me and I will give you rest? So despite the storms of life, his presence will go with us. His protection, his promise, his power, and his privilege. The winds just might start blowing. The breakers may start dashing, but my soul is anchored in the Lord. The Sea of Galilee was known for its sudden storms that would come from the surrounding hills and would whip the water into a mad frenzy. And sometimes life's sudden disasters can shake even God's own people.
Yes.
Just like in the text, the disciples left home. The sun was shining. But before you got to where you were going, the storm showed up.
Yes.
Somebody's here today who met someone that told you they loved you. They told you they wanted to be with you for the rest of their lives.
Yeah.
But after 6 months, maxed out credit cards, nowhere to live, and nothing could dry, you ended up in a storm.
Yeah.
Well, you found out he was already married, has kids older than you, found out he has no plan to leave his wife, and that he had you in his life for only one purpose. Y'all missed that.
Yeah.
And now the winds of disappointment and the waves of discouragement are beating against the fragments of your broken and destroyed dreams. What is your storm today? Maybe you're here and you got a phone call at 3 o'clock in the morning with some tragic news. The storms of life can be swift and sudden and sorrowful. What is your storm today? A few years ago, I witnessed a sudden storm. I attended a civil rights training, and on a Tuesday, one of the facilitators shared with us how she was able to win lawsuits in a number of cases. She bragged about taking down people who violated the law. Mm-hmm. And she bragged about her self-perceived invincibility. Nobody messed with her. She had the ability to take down the high and the mighty.
Yeah.
Nobody dared challenge her when she determined she had a case against them. And if she decided you had done wrong, she was going to make you pay by taking you down hard.
Well,
but then Wednesday, this confident, assertive, no-nonsense attorney collapsed to the floor, dropped herself on and screamed, "No! No!" over and over. She had a sudden storm in her family that even she had to buckle under the sorrow. Storms can and will suddenly subdue even the most unsuspecting and bring them to their knees. So no matter what you're going through, Jesus knows all about it. The scripture said that he was on the boat. And if you're in Christ, you do know he's on the boat. The waves beat into the boat, and now it was full. The disciples had given Jesus a place to sleep in the hinder part of the ship, according to verse 38.
Yes, sir.
They'd also given him a pillow, so he was sound asleep. And let me just say this. Some of the problems, or all of the problems that we think we have, Jesus can use as a pillow to rest on. And although Jesus is God in the absolute sense of the word, he is also man. And he knew what it was like to be hungry and thirsty. He knew what it was like to become weary and tired, and so he was asleep. When he first laid down, the motion of the waves and the lullaby of the breeze rocked him gently to sleep. All was well. Incidentally, this is the only occasion where we read of Jesus sleeping. But the whole passage underlines his humanity. But suddenly the storm was upon him. Perhaps they thought, Satan thought he had an opportunity. Jesus was asleep. And though he's now vulnerable, and all the devil had to do in his mind was sink the boat, he probably thought, "I've got it now, I can drown." The wind howled, the waves rolled, and the ship was being tossed mercilessly. The disciples were drenched, and they were doing everything they could to survive. Then they thought of Jesus.
Yes.
They woke him up and said, "Care us, thou not, that we perish?" And as rude as that may have sounded, they were in a panic. But one thing we must recognize of them is that they knew who to turn to.
Yeah.
They did everything they could, and then they turned to Jesus.
Yeah.
And maybe you can identify with the disciples. You said, "I've done all I can for my husband. I've done all I can for my wife. I've done all I can for my children. I've done all I can in school." The question is, have you turned to Jesus?
Yes.
Just like the disciples, the storms of life are real. And all we need to do is activate the presence of Jesus. The disciples must have been amazed that Jesus could sleep in such great danger, appearing totally unconcerned while their world was seemingly being torn apart. He was man, and his physical exhaustion had demanded payment in full. And besides, he was in his Father's care. He knew full well that it was not his Father's will that he drowned.
Well,
it wasn't his time to die.
Yes.
Verse 39 says, he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm.
Yes.
Notice the difference between what he said to the wind and what he said to the sea. He rebuked the wind, because the wind is what stirred up the waves. But he spoke peace to the waves. The wind itself is often at the mercy of other forces, like high pressure systems or low temperatures that can create hurricanes and tornadoes. But the Bible indicates that sometimes demonic forces are involved when storms wreak havoc on the world.
Yeah.
Behind the waves was the wind, but behind the wind was the evil one himself, the prince of the power of the air, validating the need for Jesus to rebuke the wind. He said to them in verse 30, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Faith and fear cancel each other out. If we have fear, we have no faith. If we have faith, we have no fear. The faith Jesus is talking about is not faith in the boat, not in the anchor, not in the sails, but faith in him. He is saying in essence to the disciples, why could you not trust me? He's saying the same thing to us. I know you're sick, but why can't you trust me? I know the doctors have diagnosed you with something new, but why can't you trust me? Your spouse don't seem to understand what you're going through, but why can't you trust me? Your child is struggling with life, trying to get their bearings straight, but why can't you trust me?
Yeah.
Verse 41 said, they feared exceedingly and said to one another, what manner of man is this?
Yes.
That even the wind and sea obey. In other words, what kind of man is this? They discovered that to voyage with Jesus was to voyage with peace, even in a storm. And it's not something that happened for the disciples. It can happen for us as well. Peace in the midst of the storm. No matter the harassment of the winds and the waves, we have his protective presence to usher us through the storms of life. Stories told of a little girl who was on the ship playing jacks in the middle of the ship. A voice on the intercom said, ladies and gentlemen, we need everyone to go to your rooms and embrace yourselves because we're in a storm. Everyone was picking up their containers and trying to prepare for the storm. They were locking their doors and putting on life jackets. But this little girl remained on the floor playing jacks. And someone asked her, young lady, aren't you going to protect yourself? She said no, and she kept on playing jacks. For those who know the game of jacks, Adrian, she was on her twosies. Man came back and said, sweetheart, aren't you going to try to hide yourself from the storm? She said, no, sir. You see, my daddy is the captain of the ship. He knows I'm on board, and he ain't gonna let nothing happen to me. I remember the song Mom's Crowd used to say, King Jesus is our captain. Go ahead and get on board. No matter how choppy the water, he goes on to say, ain't no danger in the water. Get on board. The old ship of Zion. We ought to have the same spirit that little girl had. And if you know who you are and whose you are, then you know that your daddy is on board. Way back on Calvary, he gave us a right to get on board. He died so we could ride. He was buried that we might be carried. And he rose that we could go with him into eternal bliss. But you got to get on board. And then we come to the situation where the songwriter says, when the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the world is tossing me like a ship on the raging sea, thou who rulest the wind and water, stand by me. In the midst of faults and failures, stand by me. When I do the best I can, and my friends misunderstand, thou who knowest all about me, stand by me. Just a few days before my mother died, I can imagine in the inner recesses of her mind, even in a state of Alzheimer's, saying, when I'm growing old and feeble, stand by me. When my life becomes a burden, and I'm going to cross the old chilly Jordan, thou who saved Paul and Silas, stand by me. Then Mary Baker says it when she says, Master, the tempest is raging. The billows are tossing high. The sky is overshadowed with blackness. No shelter or help is nigh. Carest thou not that we perish? How can thou not sleep? When this moment so madly is threatening,
yes,
a brave in an angry deep,
yeah,
the winds and the waves shall obey thy will.
Yes.
Peace be still.
Yes.
Peace be still.
Yes.
Peace be still. God bless you. Presence in the midst of life storms. Just help it. Pray that you help us to turn to you and to activate your presence in our lives so that we might be able to deal with the travel as we travel through life storms. We know that we're either in a storm, coming out of a storm, or going into one, but storms are always looming around us. Pray that you give us the right mentality and spirit that we might be obedient and be examples to others as we deal with life's tribulations and trials. We just pray and thank you and love you and pray that as we leave this place but not your presence, that you give us strength and grace. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us now and forever. And we all say together, Amen.